Hello everybody. Yesterday we have studied the transverse section of anther, microsporogenesis and the structure of pollen grain. Today we shall continue the topic which is development of male gametophyte. As we now have studied that the androecium in the flowers with the stamens, anther, then the pollen grains within the anther are all the male reproductive structures. The pollen grain which are produced after meiosis are the male reproductive bodies which take part in the formation of the male gametophyte. Now we also know that these pollen grains are the first cell of male gametophyte, because the pollen grains are the haploid cells. The haploid cell first form, hence the first cell of male gametophyte. The structure of pollen grain yesterday which we have studied, we will revise it in brief. A pollen grain is a unicellular, uninucleate, haploid, spherical structure developed in the anthers of these stamens. Each pollen grain externally is covered by two layers collectively called as sporoderm. The outer layer of the sporoderm is exine. Generally, exine is thick. This exine is thick when compared to the intine. The thick exine is protective and made up of a substance called sporopollenin. The sporopollenin protects the inner content of the pollen grain from the external environment. Over the surface of the exine, at some places, the exine is very thin, forming very small pores, and these are called as germ pores. The exine in case of dicotyledonous mostly is sculpture design various. Here spines can be seen over the surface of the exine. Whereas in case of monocotyledons, the exine is smooth. Internal to the exine, the thin layer of the sporoderm is called as intine. The intine is delicate and made up of cellulose and pectin. Internal to the sporoderm, the unicellular pollen grains are filled with dense cytoplasm. Within the cytoplasm, there is a haploid nucleus, n number of nucleus, which means only half the number of chromosomes are present in the pollen grain nucleus as it is formed by meiotic type of cell division or microsporogenesis. Now this pollen grain further now takes part in the development of male gametophyte. The development of the male gametophyte begins within the anthers. It begins when the pollen grains are still in the anther before the process of pollination. The development of the male gametophyte may slightly vary in different species, but the initial development of the male gametophyte from the pollen grain begins within the anthers of the flowers. First of all, the haploid pollen grain, it divides by mitosis to form two unequal cells. The larger cell here is known as vegetative cell, or another word can be used as tube cell. Whereas the smaller cell attached towards one side in the pollen grain is known to be as generative cell. So such unequal division of the nucleus and the pollen grains takes place initially. The smaller cell known to be as generative cell, whereas the larger cell known to be as the vegetative cell. The nucleus of the vegetative cell is irregular and large, whereas the generative cell nucleus is smaller when compared to both the cells. In the next step, we can concentrate now only on generative cell, where the generative cell which was attached to the wall within the pollen grain has now been separated out of the walls, and now it lies freely floating in the cytoplasm of the vegetative cell. This generative cell is very small but important with respect to development of male gametophyte. As the process of the development proceeds towards the formation of male gametophyte, the generative cell further divides by mitosis. It divides by mitosis to form two male gametes within the pollen grain. Or, in many species, the generative cell later develops into male gametophytes in the pollen tube. So the formation of male gametes from the generative cell by the process of mitosis differs in different species. In some plants, the male gametes are formed from this generative cell within the pollen grain, and sometimes the pollen male gametes are formed in the pollen tube. At this two-celled stage, in most of the angiosperms, the dehiscence of the anther takes place, and the pollen grains are carried by different pollinating agents to achieve the process of pollination. The pollen grains at two celled stage are transferred from the anther to the receptive stigma. It means pollination takes place at the two celled stage of the pollen grain in most of the species. The further development of the male gametophyte takes place on the stigma. So the development of the male gametophyte, even though simple to study, but have to remember that it takes place at two different places. 50% of the development up to the two-celled stage takes within the anther, At two cell stage, anther dehiscence. The pollen grains are carried from one flower to another flower at this stage, and on the stigma pollination takes place. And on the stigma, further development of the pollen grain is carried out. On the stigma, the pollen grain, it absorbs necessary chemical substances and water. Then the intyme, which is present towards the inner side, comes out of the germ tube. There are germ pores on the surface of the pollen grain in the exyme. The intyme on the stigma absorbs necessary chemical substances and water. The pressure is exerted from the inner side. The intyme then comes out in the form of a tube, grows first on the stigma, then develops into the style. At this moment, within the pollen tube formed from the intyme, the tip of the pollen tube is followed with the nucleus and the cytoplasm of the tube cell. It is followed by the two male gametes, the two non-motile male gametes follow the tube nucleus in the pollen tube. Now this structure, which is developed on the stigma of the carpels, that is the pollen tube, the tube nucleus and the two male gametes, are now collectively called male gametophyte. So the male gametophyte, we can now say that it is a three-celled structure. Which are those three cells? This one, the pollen tube along with the tube nucleus is one cell. The two non-motile male gametes are the other two cells. So in all, the pollen tube with the male gametes forms the male gametophyte, and hence it is a three-celled structure in angiosperms. So here, the development of male gametophyte is a simple process to study with these different kinds of diagrams. And in all the angiosperms, with slight variation, the process of development of male gametophyte is the same. 50% before pollination in the anther, and the rest 50% after pollination on the stigma. How many times the mitosis is carried out during the formation of male gametophyte from the pollen grain? Mitosis occurs twice. Once the mitosis takes place in the pollen grain to form vegetative cell and generative cell. The second time, mitosis occurs in the generative cell to form two male gametes. So from pollen grain up to the formation of male gametophyte, mitosis occurs twice. And in all, the male gametophyte is a three-celled structure. The three-celled structure consists of the pollen tube, the tube nucleus and the two male gametes. With this, we come to the end of the formation of the male gametes. We started the topic with flower, the sexual reproduction of angiosperms from the flower. Androecium,
consisting of stamens, fertile part anther. Within the anther, microsporogenesis takes place and pollen grains are formed. The pollen grains then develop into the male gametophyte. The male gametophyte finally shows the presence of male gametes. Now let us study something about the female world, then the process of the formation of female gametophyte, the structure of ovule, etc. So in these two periods we have studied up to the formation of male gametes. Next we shall now study how the structure of female reproductive world is present, then the structure of carpel. Within the structure of carpel, we have to study the structure of a single ovule, and within the ovule, the female gamete or egg is produced. Gynoecium is the female reproductive world, and the gynoecium consists of ovary, style and stigma. So here gynoecium consists of ovary, style and stigma, or we can say that the gynoecium is the innermost whorl of the flower. Gynoecium is made up of carpels. This is the structure of a single carpel. A single carpel consists of basal. Enlarged part of the carpel is called ovary. The ovary is the most fertile part, consisting of ovules. The middle slender part of the carpel is called style, and the upper enlarged sticky part of the carpel is called stigma. We can now say that these stigma, style and ovary are the three main parts of a typical carpel. And of these three, the main part is the ovary. The basal part of the carpel, which is enlarged, containing the ovules, is the fertile part of the carpel, or say the gynoecium. The gynoecium, we also know that it is also called as pistil. In many plants, the ovary consists of single ovule. Here I have shown single ovule. Such a ovary is known as uniovulate ovary. The examples are, the different types of examples are given in the textbook. Mostly sunflower is also an example in where it is uniovulate, and many other examples are also given. And in many plants such as the hibiscus, then the brinjal or tomato, these are all multiovulate ovaries. So in some plants the ovary is single, has single ovule, called uniovulate ovary. And in many other plants, the ovary has many ovules, known to be as multiovulate ovary. We can also study of the number of carpels in the flower. In some plants, the gynoecium consists of only one carpel. In some many carpels. When there are many carpels, unicarpellar gynoecium, common is pea plant. All the leguminous plants have only one carpel in their flower. Whereas the multicarpellary ovary, it may be apocarpus or syncarpus. Even though all such aspects, unicarpellary, multicarpellary, then apocarpus gynoecium, syncarpus gynoecium, we have studied all these things in the 11th standard. But once again, few of the aspects are repeated in the textbook, in the 12th standard book also. So just we will revise it. What is apocarpus gynoecium? If a flower consists of many carpels and all the carpels are free from one another, such a gynoecium is known as apocarpus gynoecium. Example, Mycelia, rose are the common examples of apocarpus gynoecium. Many carpels, all the carpels free from one another. Whereas syncarpus gynoecium means within a flower there are many carpels, 1, 2, 3, many carpels, and all of them are attached to one another in one region or the other. Such carpels is known as syncarpus gynoecium. In brinjal or in other tomato, etc., the gynoecium is syncarpus. So now we are studying the female reproductive world. The female reproductive world within a flower is called as gynoecium. It is also known to be as pistil. The gynoecium consists of carpels. Each carpel consists of three main parts: ovary, style, stigma. Ovary is the basal enlarged part consisting of ovules. In many plants, the ovary is univovulate. In many others, it is multiovulate. The middle slender part is called style, and the upper enlarged sticky feathery part of the carpel is called as stigma. Now, why do we call the ovary as the fertile part? Because it contains ovules, and the ovule in turn produces the female gamete. We can here also know that the fruits which we see on the plants are also developed from the ovaries itself, and the ovules which are present in the ovary after fertilization, they develop into seeds. Hence, regarding the ovary and the ovules, we have to study everything in detail. So, in the ovary, ovule is the fertile part. Within the ovule, female gamete is developed. Therefore, now let us concentrate our study on the structure of this ovule. There are many different types of ovules. Now, let us first of all define ovule. What is an ovule? What is ovule? The integumented megasporangium enclosed in the ovaries is called as ovule. How to define an ovule? The integumented megasporangium is called ovule. So now the word mega is coming. While we were studying the stamens or the pollen sacs, the pollen grains, the word micro was used. Here, the word mega is used in the female reproductive system. The carpels can be compared to megasporophylls. The ovule can be compared to megasporangium. Then, within the ovule, megaspore mother cell is developed. From the megaspore mother cell, the megaspores are formed. So all mega, mega, mega in case of females, and micro, micro, micro in case of male reproductive systems. So the integumented ovule, here the integumented megasporangium is called as ovule. There are many different structures of ovule when we study in different types of plants, but the most common type of ovule as far as its structure is concerned is the anatropous ovule. And here we shall today study the anatropous ovule. Let us draw the diagram of anatropous ovule. The ovule which bend downwards and comes nearer to the stalk of the ovary is known as anatropous ovule. The anatropous ovule can also be called as inverted ovule. These ovules or any ovule is attached within the ovary. It is attached in the ovary in the region of placenta. So here this is placenta and this is the ovule. So the cushion like nourishing tissue present in the ovary on which ovules are developed is called placenta. The nourishing tissue on which ovules are developed in the ovary is called placenta. Now here we can see that the placenta bears the ovules. Now this ovule is anatropous ovule, which we are going to study in details as per our syllabus. What is anatropous ovule? Or first of all, once again, let us know what is an ovule. Integumented megasporangium is called ovule. What is megasporangium? We shall learn it later, or we will come to it later. But here, integumented megasporangium is called ovule. And in that ovule, we are going to learn anatropous ovule. Now, what is anatropous ovule? The ovule in which the body bends downwards and the micropyle comes closer to the funicle or the stalk of the ovule is called anatropous ovule. It is also called as inverted ovule. The stalk of the ovule is called funicle. The body is attached to the placenta with the help of funicle. The attachment of the funicle with the body of the ovule is known as hilum. The point of attachment of the funicle with the body of ovule is called
hyla. The central part, the central important part of the ovule is known as nucellus. This nucellus is the diploid main tissue or megasporangium proper of the ovule. The structures, the integuments and the inner embryo sac, all these structures are developed from the cells of nucellus. Therefore, it is the main part initially which develops later the inner female gametophyte or embryo sac and the outer integuments. There are two integuments. Those are known to be as outer integument and another one is inner integument. Such ovules with two integuments are known as bitechnic ovules. If there is only one integument, it is known to be as unitechnic ovule. Most of the ovules with two integuments, one and two layers, outer integument and inner integument are present, and these are bitechnic ovules. These integuments, they protect the inner parts of the ovule. The basal part of the ovule is called chalaza. The basal part of the ovule or the nucellus is called chalaza. And the integument arises from the chalazal part of the ovule. These integuments are developed to protect the inner parts on all sides except leaving a very small opening at the apex called as micropyle. So, at the apex, the tip, here we have to remember that this is apex. As this is at the top, you can't say that this is apex. Initially, the ovule is straight. Initially, the ovule is to be considered as straight. And later, this apex, it is apex. Later, this apex bends down. Here, the apex bends down, and therefore, the apex comes once again nearer to the bottom. So, the minute, tubular, microscopic opening present at the apex in the integuments of the ovule is called micropyle. What is micropyle? It is a minute microscopic opening present at the tip, the apex of the ovule, and it is micropyle. Now, within the nucellus, the main central parenchymatous tissue, female gametophyte is enclosed in the embryo sac. Female gametophyte is enclosed in the embryo sac. This is the embryo sac. These are the central one is egg, whereas the lateral ones are synergics. This is egg or female gamete. The two cells
to the side of the egg are known as synergids. The three cells towards the chalazam side are called antipodals. And these two are polar nuclei. The synergids and egg in the embryo sac collectively are called egg apparatus. These are polar nuclei and these are antipodals. So all these structures here are haploid, because all these structures within the embryo sac, all these structures within the embryo sac represent the female gametophyte. And these female gametophytes is developed by the process of megasporogenesis. How it happens, how the cells are developed, we have to study in detail in the next period. But just remember that within the embryo sac, this is embryo sac. And in the embryo sac, the structures present are all haploid, are nothing but the structures of female gametophyte. It means that the embryo sac encloses 8 nucleate or 7 cell structure, which is commonly called as female gametophyte. So, gynoecium, female reproductive world, another world, pistil, consists of carpels, ovary-style stigma, parts of the typical carpel. If a flower has many carpels free from one another, it is apocarpous gynoecium. If a flower has many carpels united with one another, it is a syncarpous gynoecium. The ovary, fertile part. Within the ovary, ovule, most important and most fertile one. In the ovary, if one ovule is present, it is univolate ovary. If many ovules are present, multi-ovulate ovary. Ovule is the important structure, as female gamete is produced in the ovule. When we study ovule, we know the definition. Integumented megasporangium is called ovule. Many different types of ovules. We have to study in detail only anatropous ovule. How to define anatropous ovule? The ovule in which the body is bent downwards and the apex comes nearer to the funicle or placenta is called anatropous ovule. As the body is completely bent, the ovule can be called, also called as inverted ovule. This is the structure of anatropous ovule or inverted ovule. What are the major parts of the ovule? The funicle, hilum, integuments, nucellus, chalaza, micropyle. Internally, embryo sac consisting of the egg apparatus, polar nuclei, antipodals, that is all collectively called as female gametophyte, are all these structures which are present in a well developed ovule. Each part of the ovule has its own special functions. Funicle attaches the ovule on the placenta. Nucellus, parenchymatous fertile part which develops the integuments as well as the inner embryo sac. Outer and inner integuments, they protect the inner parts of the ovule. Micropyle, it helps in the entry of the pollen tube during the process of fertilization within the embryo sac or in the ovule. The egg, the female gamete, is the most important one because it takes part in fertilization. Synergids of the female gametophyte help in the process of fertilization. The antipodals, they degenerate. The polar nuclei are also important as they later take part in the process of the formation of endosperm. So what we have learned today, the female reproductive gynoecium, carpels, ovary, and within the ovary, the structure of anatropous ovule. So read from the textbook in detail, follow the diagram properly, then you can understand the anatropous ovule as well as you can learn all the labelings properly and their functions also. So today we shall stop here. Thank you.